All right, welcome to the podcast, a very soggy podcast. Yeah, it's finally a sunny, bright, beautiful day outside here, and I decided I'm just...
And you fucked it up.
Yeah, it's like this being dry stuff, that's crap.
But, I can't get the water in me.
No way I can drink 8 fucking glasses of water. Maybe if I just dump it on myself, it'll absorb through my skin.
That's a spirit.
Yeah. So, anyway.
Welcome to the show.
Yes, how are you doing, Ben?
I'm fine.
You're fucking just fine.
Yeah, I started my day getting mad, and so now I'm like... Shut the hell up. I'm always like depleted by the time we do the show, but it's even worse when like you get pissed off at something earlier in the day and you're like, man, if I had this energy for the show, it would be a fucking great show. And now it's just like, I don't even care. I want the fucking world to end.
It's amazing how often that happens. Like it'll be normally Wednesday mornings, I wake up and completely forget about the show because that's not the first thing I think about. Wednesday is just another shitty day and you go to work. Then it'll be like 11 o'clock and I'm like, hey, it's podcast day. And I'm
you
like,
realize it's an even worse day than you started.
But I'm normally like in the early afternoon. I'm like, oh, I'm right. Podcast. This will be good this week. I've got energy and stuff to talk about and whatever. And by the time it's time to actually do the show, I think we're both just like,
yeah. Fuck. Yeah, it's a real just sort of like, what's the point? Like, you get home from work and you're like, you know, like you can feel it through the show. Like, you're thinking about dinner usually, and I'm usually thinking about food anyway, just because I'm a pig. So it's just like, well, the last thing I want to do is like really, like I do like doing the show, but I don't have the energy for it by this time of the day.
Yeah, that's the biggest thing. It's like, and it's funny because everything, like I always want to tweet, be like, well, I guess it's time for the show. But I'm like, that makes it sound like we don't care or don't want
or
to do
anyone,
it.
Or that anyone makes us right? do it. But, that there's any stake to us doing the show beyond our own personal amusement. But
yeah, it's much less to do with like want to or like to, and it's just energies at a
like,
just
it's
nil.
What you think you're capable of. It's like, you know, it always seems to go okay, but then like starting out, you're always like, how the fuck are we going to talk for an hour and a half? Like, like how can two wordy fucks who have such an attention complex that they started their own fucking show? Like, how could they actually carry a show again? But you start your day and you're just like, the energy just is completely dead by 3 o'clock for me. Like, I spent all my energy today playing fetch with a fucking horrible dog. So that's my expenditure for
that. Is like our new running theme on the show, though, is like just you and your dog, I don't know which one to use, the protagonist and which one's the villain, but it's just there. I think you're both villains.
Well, I wouldn't agree with that. I would say, because I can actually describe the relationship, she's the villain. It's up to me, so.
Yeah, but I know you after so many years of doing the podcast, and I have a hard time casting you in the hero role. But
there's a hole in my pillowcase, so you know that's exhibit one. I can go through everything she's destroyed.
Yeah, that's what we talked about, because my older dog died like 2 years ago. In fact, 2 years ago in 5 days. Not that I keep track, but
but you totally do.
Do, yeah. That was tough because I grew up with that dog. She was 13 years old. But anyway, well, that's one of the things we talked about is like, you know, right away you don't want. And that's like one of the first questions people ask, because it's that awkward like, oh, my dog died. And people are like, oh, shit, are you going to get another one? And the week after my dog's dead, don't ask me about like replacing her, because no. But of course, we talked about that afterwards, especially since we have another dog and it's. We were like, we weren't sure if she would like transition well to being an only dog. But you always forget about the puppy phase. Or at least my wife does. She's always like, yeah, it'd be great. We should get another dog. Oh, she'd love it and whatever. And it's like, yeah, but we're not home for 8 hours a day because we work together. And puppies chew everything. Everything.
Yeah.
And they're
have no self-control.
They're hyper and they need trains. And it's... and it's,
I mean, to be fair, you and your wife... judging from your like Twitter feed, like you do get out on like weekends and stuff in a way that would, like, you're way more active than my household is.
Well, and we're fortunate to have
a lot of that energy, but
and we have the fenced in yard, so we usually let like our dog. We have well, even
and you don't have neighbors them. Like 2 feet from your house every direction. So
we do, but they all have. Well, actually, the neighbors on both sides don't have dogs, but they like our dogs. And that's only because the neighbors on either the other sides of them have shitty dogs. So,
yeah.
But anyway, I don't.
Yeah.
I don't know. That makes 4 weeks in a row, I think, starting with dogs. But I, in fairness, I'd be perfectly cool doing a dog cast. Like, I like dogs. I don't have anything to say about them really, but
That's what I know now about myself is I don't like dogs. Like I end up liking my dogs to an extent, but it's almost this begrudging, like familiarity with them that, like, okay, I can deal with you. But every other dog just, like, I've ever met, just, they're always insane.
Yeah.
That's
the other thing. We're spoiled because the one that we have now, the one that died, I loved her, but she was a fucking brat. Like, ugh. But, the one we have now is like, we're spoiled because she's about the best dog, like, temperament wise you could possibly act for. We can get her treats out and like hand her one so she knows it's like her treats and it's time for her to get them. And then put the rest on the coffee table and just sit there and she won't take them. She'll look at them and look at you like, what the fuck are you doing, you asshole? Like, can I please have those?
I will make you pay for this one day.
There's very few things that she does that she's not supposed to do. She does love to get into tissues, which is weird, but
yeah, that, like, one of my cats is like that about toilet paper. Just like has to like destroy any roll of toilet paper. You have to hide it from her. But they're like, one of the dogs, the last dog we put down, he was the one I grew up with, and he had that same temperament. Like, he was a perfect fit for us. He was, you know, he was a pain in the ass once he got older and, you know, health started going downhill. But he was very mellow about everything. And, you know, he would play with you if you wanted to play. But he was just happy to be there. And once he died, I was like, I try to see the pros and cons of everything, which is, you know, this sucks. But we, you know, this it's also a lot less stressful. Not having a dog to take care of. But nobody else in my family has that thing of just like, how about we just not have something depend on us for a little while? And they're like, of course, like, fucking my family's looking at new dogs like right away. And it's like, you know, really to me, it's just like, well, think about it. Wouldn't it be great to just sleep in, you know, and nothing bark?
And that's kind of the other thing when we think about like another dog, we'd get, you know, a puppy or at least a young dog. But as much as I love our dog, the one like thing that kind of sucks about it is if you want to just do like a 4-day trip, like a road trip or something, it's like you either have to leave the dog with somebody or board her, which we don't like doing, or plan your whole trip around things that you can do with a dog, which is great. Yeah. But it does severely limit you because it's like you can't even go out to eat.
Yeah, like if I just want to fucking up and go somewhere, I have to like think about like, well, who's going to take care of these animals and stuff? And cats are easy because cats, you can just leave out enough food and they'll figure it out. You know, give them a clean litter box, you know, maybe two. And if you have more than one cat and then, or just let them fucking piss wherever.
Make sure you've got two cats and say, one of you eat the other one. That'll be fine.
Yeah, just fight, you know, just break a pool cue like in the Dark Knight and be like, you know, winner gets the house.
When animal control shows up to you, say it's Darwinism, bitch.
It was weird. Today when I was playing with my dog, there was like a dead lizard in my yard.
Do you get a lot of lizards in Washington?
Fucking no. I've never seen him. And it was just like dead in my lawn. Hmm. And I was like, is somebody sending me a message? Because
the weirdest, like, yeah, the Washington Mafia, they're just very obscure with their threats.
Well, I mean, I was thinking more supernatural, like, you know, because this is the start of a horror movie. We'll do this show and then you'll find out I died, got my head ripped off or some shit by a fucking ghost in a VCR. Don't ask me why I still have a VCR.
Just for ghosts.
Just for ghosts. Yeah. Just in case there's a ghost and wants to talk.
Yeah, DVD players don't play ghost stuff. But
not really, because, I mean, like, that's... Despite what creepypastas tell you, like, it's too easy to, like, copy and shit. Like, you can only get supernatural data onto tape.
Right.
That can melt in the sun.
No, see, I was picturing the mafia, like, just some guy named Knuckles, like, see, boss, what if we put a lizard in his yard? If he finds it, he'll get the message.
Apparently. Yeah, I think they would, like, nail it to the door or something.
Well, no, but that's what I mean. They're, like, he's the worst, like, goon ever. Like, it's like the horse head in your bed thing, but he didn't want to actually, like, he's like, well, if we nail it to the door, it might cause some property damage. We'll leave it in the yard. He'll find it.
Yeah, this was actually, that reminds me, one day, like, this dog, it was, bitch face, I call her affectionately. She, like, I woke up one morning and I felt like, she never does this with me, but I felt like fur under my covers. And normally, like, I'm used to, like, my cats,
I finally have hair down with me.
And it's like, wow, yeah, I grew up. No, but I felt it with, like, my foot. I was like, what the fuck is down there? I look under the covers and her fucked up, like, she has one blue eye, so that's always, like, shining in the darkness and stuff, and she's black and white, and it was scarier. Like, I would have rather have found a horse head under my blankets. And I had the same reaction as, like, dude in The Godfather.
I think I've talked about it on the show before, but one of the, like, scariest things ever for me with my dogs, I don't know if you ever, I assume it's, like, a condition that's common to, like, all humans, or at least people that dream. And I know some people say they don't have dreams, but sometimes I'll have those dreams, like, real early in the morning where, like, you kind of, like, in the dream, you realize it's a dream, but you also realize that you're kind of awake, and you get to this, like, weird point where you don't know if you're still asleep or if you're awake and, like, just a little groggy. Yeah. And they just turn into, like, it always happens to me right before I wake up. They just get, the super realistic dreams. But I was having one that was, like, really, really fucked up. Like, and it's always about me, like, I'm dreaming that I'm laying in bed. So that's part of the problem where you can't tell the difference. It's not like I'm out, like, flying through the clouds. But there's just, like, one of those things where you can just feel, like, an evil presence in the room. And it's a dream, so you just, like, kind of know it's, like, a demon. And all of a sudden, it's, like, Tara, my wife's possessed by this demon or something. And it's, like, breathing in my face. And then I wake up, and I realize my stupid dog was standing next to the bed because she was ready to go out. And she was doing that thing that a lot of dogs do where they put their face, like, right in your face and just sit there. Like, she, didn't touch me, but it was just the dog breathing on me, and her hot, like, dog breath was translated to demon breath, which is a pretty close translation.
Really. Yeah, you get some Silent Hill vibes from that.
Yeah. Now, by the time I fully woke up and realized what was going on, she had, like, given up, but she did it so often that I was able to, I was just like, once I had my senses, it's like, I'm glad I didn't wake up and, like, bludgeon Tara to death thinking she's a demon.
Or there totally was a demon.
Oh, yeah, that's true.
But you're just trying to justify it with something from reality. you know, but that's between you and your priest.
Priest, yeah.
But it's interesting, like, when you hear people say they don't dream, because, like, I always thought, and maybe this is just a theory, but, like, a lot of the times, like, you don't remember your own dreams.
Yeah, and that's kind of what I've always assumed.
So you can't really say, oh, I don't dream. It's like, you actually have no idea if you dream or not, because a lot of dreams are so And I heard it's that the more intense the dream is, the less likely you are to remember it.
So that explains all my dreams where I'm just sitting in a chair, like twiddling my thumbs.
Yeah, like, you know, there's a few dreams I had over my life that, like, I made a point to remember. But there's a lot of dreams that even, like, when you wake up and you're like, oh shit, I, like, that was really scary. By the end of the day, you won't remember it really at all.
That's hilarious how often that happens, where you wake up, you're like, wow, there's something about that dream. You're like, I'll never forget that dream. And then, like, you eat breakfast, you're like, what did I dream about?
Right.
Like, your brain is actively, like, when you wake up and remember the dream, I think your brain's like, it's like that Inside or whatever, that Pixar movie where the little characters in your brain are running around like, oh fuck, we forgot to delete it. Destroy. Yeah,
if my brain was like that, all the operators would be drunk and, like, miserable. And it's like, oh fuck, he wants to work out again. Flip the switch.
Like, your head, you just keep hearing roll out the barrels, like, being slurred out. And you're like, where is that coming from?
Yeah, it's like, why do I always want whiskey?
Well, that's kind of explaining a lot for me, but
they need to show that. They need to tell that sequel when, like, she's older and life hasn't worked out.
Or get really fucking dark and real with it and show it when her grandmother gets Alzheimer's. Like,
that's when people are getting murdered in the brain. Like, just like, that's weird. Three people haven't come into work in the last 2 weeks. Like, where are they?
They could even call it bodies. Not all there inside. or CSI inside. Or what is
that? That's better. Yeah. CS inside.
But we're genius. I don't know why Hollywood hasn't. And I always refer to Hollywood as, like, a singular entity. Like, there's a Mr. Like, yeah. Hi, I am Hollywood. The president of Hollywood. And I don't know why.
Hollywood Incorporated. Here's your five movie rules.
Right. I don't know why they haven't called us up and been like, hey, guys, you've got so many awesome ideas between your podcast and Twitter. You need to write us a movie. Because, I mean, frankly, some of that shit that's out there.
There are people on Reddit doing this fucking exact same thing, and they can just take those ideas for free.
That's true. No, they're totally original that just happen to resemble threads that you may have seen.
May or may not have seen. I mean, really, who reads Reddit, honestly?
Speaking of movies, we saw Kong Skull Island yesterday. That's sure a movie.
This is about a monkey.
Yeah, big monkey. Really big monkey.
All he does for the children.
Well, basically, yeah. It's a good. I wanted to see it. I've been wanting to see it, but not like, oh, this movie's going to be great. It's more like this is going to be ridiculously stupid. I can't wait to see it. And, I mean, it is. Like, it's not. It's just a movie you can't take seriously, but it's a modern King Kong movie, so you shouldn't be walking in there.
You shouldn't take old King Kong very seriously, because it's about a giant fucking monkey who, like, humanity thinks the best idea is to bring it back to fucking, like, New York or wherever the fuck. And, like, you know, honestly, our chains didn't work.
Honestly, if we were to discover Skull Island and find King Kong and capture him today, I could see Trump doing that. That would be the next Trump Tower. Like, that would be that man's first thought. Like,
I hope that's true, because that increases the chance that morons get killed by a giant monkey. And I'm all for that.
Right. And maybe we'll get to bring biplanes back.
If anyone sees King Kong and their thought is, how can we get it? You know, then I want you to die. You know, because your reaction should be, I'm getting the fuck out of here.
I assume once we clamp this iron shackle to it, it'll calm down.
How the fuck do you see a giant monkey on an island and have the nerve to think that could be my island? Like,
that could be my monkeys. Fuck the island. We'll take it home.
We'll take the monkey. It's like, you need the monkey to beat up the giant insects.
Well, yeah.
All right. It's all about an ecosystem. All right. So, like, this shit about let's capture the monkey, fuck that. You just let giant spiders loose upon the world.
See, the rest of the movie is relatively plausible. The original, I mean, where they bring it back to New York or whatever and chain it. It's relatively plausible, except I have one dog that's not very big, and it still cost a fortune to feed her. There's no way they would have made him enough money off that monkey to pay for all the food that monkey would need to sustain itself at that size. Like,
well, that's probably why they were able to kill the monkey, because he probably was, like,
malnourished
and shit. I really feel for King Kong, man. Like if he came a little bit later, Planet of the Apes would have started. He would have been fine. He would have been top dog.
He would have literally been King Kong.
What the fuck would goddamn Caesar do against King Kong? He's like, well, I want to be in charge. I want to be in charge. Splat. Yeah. And he's just like, well, you're not.
Well, you can't even.
My literal name is King.
Right. I mean, it's right there. Is your name King Caesar? I don't think so.
Caesar, like, the only fucking claim to fame you have with Caesar is, like, the asshole got stabbed by his own people. You know?
Well, and he makes a pretty dope salad, but if you're in the mood for it.
Yeah, great salad. That's the legacy of Caesar. Great salad.
It is an honor to have that salad named after you, because it's one of those salads that it's like, yeah, here's a salad, it's healthy, except it's also 470,000 calories because of all the shit we're putting into it.
We put fucking cheese and shit on it.
Right.
Like, you know what would be great with salad? Everything else you want to eat when you're eating a salad.
Yeah, let's put some eggs on it and cheese and then
fried chicken strips on the salad. Why not?
What kind of dressing? How about a cheese dressing?
Yeah. Fuck it. You know, I'm already eating a salad. I'm already being healthy. Don't tell me how to be healthy, world.
Right. As long as this guy, I live my life like that. And that explains why I go to the gym so often and haven't lost a pound. But it's like, if you put it on top of lettuce, it's healthy. I mean,
right. That's the thing. You're like, I'm eating green shit.
Right.
You know, who cares if it's mission between two fried buns?
So we are a video game show, theoretically.
We're whatever we want to be.
Yeah.
Okay. I don't want to hear that. Like, don't typecast me. Okay. I can talk about whatever I want.
That's why President Hollywood hasn't called us up. We've been typecast. We're just
They're just a video game podcast. We are much, 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 much more. But yeah, I played the Dark Souls 3 DLC, and I wrote about it. So yes,
here's the most hilarious thing about that. Like, the idea of writing something on our site is so foreign to me by this point that Jackie, I don't know her last name, Geeky Fried Rice Geek Fried Rice on Twitter retweeted it, but all I saw was like, the thumbnail. I thought she wrote it. It's like, oh, I need to read that at some point. And then like 4 hours later, I'm looking over at the Njoystic timeline. I'm like, wait, Ben wrote that. Yeah. But and it was a really cool read through because it kind of just wraps up your experiences with the Souls series, including Bloodborne.
I wanted to write that because in a lot of ways, my time with Dark Souls is like, it's one of the more important points of like writing for Njoystic and doing the show and stuff. Like, I never would have played the first game if you and me hadn't, you know, teamed up for this shit. Because I never would have bought the game. I guess I couldn't say never, like, but yeah, it was very unlikely. It was not something I thought I would enjoy at all. And once you sent me a copy, I was like, you know, I was certain I would still hate it, but
that's
I
haven't exploited nearly enough is that if you get sent something, it doesn't matter what it is, you'll pretty much play it.
Right. Like, right.
And you play pretty much everything to completion too. So, almost. Yeah. So when all these shitty games on Steam come on sale, I need to be like buying them and sending it to you. Like, oh, look.
I'll try anything, and my thought was like it would be great fodder for this show if I just talked about how miserable Dark Souls was making me, and I definitely got mileage out of that, but I didn't expect that, like, you know, years later we would still be talking about Dark Souls every other fucking show about like all the cool things those games do, and that I would actually, it would become one of my favorite series. So, you know, like, once it was, like, it was weird playing this last DLC, and when I finally beat it, just knowing, like, this is, you know, for the foreseeable future, at least, this is it. You know, and there's still going to be plenty of games that, you know, more or less take it, like, take sort of that formula and apply it to their own game and stuff. So, like, I don't feel like we're going to, like, lose Dark Souls-style games anytime soon. But, it, like, there's something to be said about, like, the originator of that formula, you know, and them sort of putting a cap on it all. Well,
and that's the thing, too. At this point, other games have started emulating it, and, you know, Neo even did it pretty well. But nobody's done it to the level of Dark Souls yet, because it's...
Or they were trying to do something different, like how, you know, it, like the Dark Souls had a lot of series, as a series, had a lot of ups and downs, you know, so like I could see situations where it's like, actually, you know, I kind of prefer certain elements of Neo to what Dark Souls does. But they are different enough that it's like, you know, no game is ever going to fully capture exactly what Dark Souls set out to do. And so, you know, I wanted to write something that just sort of, you know, capped it all off, like where it kind of started for me, how it progressed, and, you know, how I felt walking away from it.
Sad.
Yeah, totally. And especially 'cause the last DLC, I think overall is pretty good. It's got some problems though, and a lot of them I felt were kind of at the first half of it, and in some cases it's not necessarily a problem, it's just a problem like the player has to deal with, in that it is really fucking punishing, like even by Dark Souls standards, like there's a lot of shit just in the environment that can like one shot you.
Yeah, I did see though that they just patched it today and toned some of that stuff down.
Yeah, and that's great now that I'm fucking done with it.
No, that's my first thought. Sucked. It's like the day after you write about finishing it, they're like, okay, now we'll fix it.
Yeah, because in the beginning, in the first half, there are these angels. And the location you go to for the Ring City DLC is really cool. Like, it's kind of this just ash-covered wasteland, but, like, there's elements of it where you almost feel like you're traveling sort of back and forth through this like weird corner of Dark Souls history. So like there are times where you're like in the real like city on the verge of collapse, but then you like travel forward to like where it's all just fucking ruin and wasteland. So that's kind of neat. But in that first part, there are these fucking angels that if they see you, they just fucking just hellfire just rains down on you no matter what you're doing, and you have to run for cover, and you have to, you know, like you have to sprint everywhere you go and like really kind of take advantage of like openings to like they'll track you a little bit, and then like once you're hidden they'll turn around and you got to take advantage of like whenever their back's not to you, because it takes them a while to set up their attack animation. But there are some stretches where you're running where they will fucking kill you, just like it's too long of a stretch and there's no cover in between, and like I just had to get, it sucks, but you just kind of have to get lucky. It's probably better now because those guys don't do as much damage since the patch, but it's fucking, it was a nightmare at the time.
When you get hit though, that was one of the things with Dark Souls, is there's always been these enemies where it's like they hit you and they don't necessarily do like a ton of damage. They may take out a, you know, good chunk, but it's like you can survive a hit, except it like tends to stagger you, and a lot of times you end up just getting fucked up before you can like get back to.
That doesn't really happen with these because the projectiles aren't like, they kind of plan that, because if you're getting hit by one, even without a stagger, you're getting hit by probably 10 more. So it's one of those things, like even when you're rolling, you're just getting pelted. So you're not really like locked into place by doing it. But like if the run is so far from like cover, then you're just, it felt kind of lucky that I got through the part that was giving me the most problems. And it kind of sucks because you can shoot those guys with arrows and they die, but then another one reappears immediately.
So there's no point in killing him.
Well, how you actually kill him is, it turns out there's these fucked up like corpse things that are summoning them, and they're always hidden. So
it's kind of like the catacombs in Dark Souls 1 with the necromancers.
except like a million times worse.
Because skeletons like, were just, like just chumps. They're just like, oh no, smack. But
yeah, these guys will fuck you up. But you know, like once you kind of get through all that stuff, you get to the first boss, and like the first boss isn't that bad, but like the first two bosses of this DLC, there are four in total. The first two bosses, I kind of do shit that I don't really like about Dark Souls. Like I don't like juggling like boss monsters. So when you fall into this pit and you have to fight two demons at the same time, and to be fair, they're not that hard. But once you kill one of them, it determines like what order you killed them determines what like giant demon you have to fight next, which is the real kind of boss fight. And you have to like anytime you die, you have to fight the two fucking demons again. And there's really no strategy to it. It's just sort of back off, hit them, and then run away because they're gonna fucking lose their minds. And
it kind of sounds like the gargoyles fight.
Kind of, but the gargoyle fight, like you can, like there's a little more strategy to that because it's just those two, and you can kind of take one gargoyle down a fair bit. This is just two straight up demons and then one fuck you demon. but once you get it down to that one demon, like it's actually a pretty cool fight. The second boss fight I thought was terrible. And it's terrible for a weird reason because there is a real enemy to it. But if you're connected online, which I always am, because that's just, that's Dark Souls. I never know when I'm going to summon somebody or get summoned. So it's, you know, that's just how I have the game always set up. If you do that, it turns into like a PvP fight where people who join this one specific covenant in the DLC get summoned for this boss fight. And it's another boss fight where they get infinite NPC summons to help them. It's always one at a time, but anytime you kill that guy, they come back after a few minutes. And there's a third guy who you have to kill because he'll summon shit quicker. So it's another fucking, you know, if you just go in without help, it's another goddamn 3-on-1. And it's a PvP fight, so you got that fucking lovely PvP lag that Dark Souls is known for.
Yeah, well, not only that, but like 3v1, when it's NPCs you're fighting, they at least have patterns and stuff that you can learn. A player is just an unpredictable player. Like, you have to...
Yeah, and they have like these spells that just, you know, like, they always have these spells that are... you know, like they're not player decision spells. It's just part of the boss fight that you have to deal with. And it's fucked up. The first time I fought the guy, the dude had a fucking shield that just, it's like, all right, well, you're completely unhittable. Like he was just a giant turtle basically. And like, I couldn't hit him, and he couldn't really hit me because he was always defending. So it was just one of those things like, well, I guess, you know, the NPCs are going to just whittle me away while he fucking stands there in a giant suit of armor I can't break. The second time I fought a guy with a giant fucking sword who, like, I got him kind of close, but it was just that thing of, like, there's too much going on. Once the NPCs kept getting summoned and shit, like I ran out of healing items. And like at this point, I'm getting frustrated because it's like, it's hard enough if it was a 1-on-1 fucking PvP fight, you know? So to have like this asshole that's just a computer AI flipping around the PvP opponent, throwing shit at me, like that's a nightmare. And then the third try, and I guess, you know, thanks goes out to whoever this was just a dude with two shields who just stood there while I backstabbed him.
It's like somebody that realizes how bullshit the fight is and they're like, here, just kill me.
Yeah, a good Samaritan, I guess. You know, and it was kind of like that thing, like, this fight sucks, and that's a shitty way to beat it, but I don't like it. So I don't really care. Like, I don't like the idea of it. And I didn't know that, like, you have to go offline to fight the actual boss of that. It's just basically a PvP opponent, but it's an AI.
Yeah, and that, I don't know though, it being like what the part of Souls that I like the most is like all that lore. And even if it's just some generic like PvP type guy, I'd be a little upset to like know I missed him because I just default to, because I always play connected too.
Right.
Just because I never bothered to turn it off. Like although I did, I think I summoned help for pretty much every fight in Dark Souls 3, in the vanilla. I haven't played any of the DLC.
Yeah. Yeah, I summoned help for that fight. I summoned help for the demon fight. It's not a good fight. Like, and PvP is not why I play those games. I know a lot of people really like it.
I think those people are weird, though.
Yeah, I agree. I think it is a fun little, like, to goof around. I'll summon someone to fight, or I'll activate like a covenant that summons me or something. Like, it's a fun thing to like go into somebody else's game or have them come into yours and just see like the level disparity and the equipment disparity and stuff. Like, I don't mind the feature, but for them to like make it like, no, this is a mandatory boss fight in this
Right.
DLC, that sucks. I
Yeah,
think
that would be
that's just a
the.
poor idea.
No, I will say, like, the most I ever did with the, other than, like, summoning help for the fights, I did, after I beat Dark Souls 3, spend a lot of time. I think I spent the next week or two just, like, hanging out, doing that, Dragon Slayer armor fight, like, helping people with that. Just
Yeah.
because that's such a cool boss fight, and it was a hard one. And it's funny because probably 8 out of 10 or 9 out of 10 times I'd get summoned, it would go horribly, and I'd just be probably more of a burden than anything. Because the other thing with those games, you can summon people and it helps, but the more people you have summoned, the tougher the bosses are, or
Yeah.
at least like the more health that they have and that kind of thing. So the times when there'd be a couple times you get summoned and you just fuck up your positioning and get killed almost immediately. It's like, whoops.
Yeah,
What?
yeah.
But then when you did actually help somebody beat it, and you could tell it was always for like their first time, it's just a good feeling to like help somebody with that, because that has to be probably not my favorite, but one of my favorite boss encounters from all the games. I've only played a little bit of two, but that was such a cool encounter.
Yeah, and
Especially.
I can safely tell you there's no boss fight in Dark Souls 2 that is really any better than anything in 3 or 1. So,
Yeah, I think all my favorites are still for. Well, like Dragon Slayer would be up there. I really love the Abyss Walkers in. Or
yeah, that's a really cool fight. Just and
it's.
it's a really cool setting for a
Yeah, it's like a
fight.
neat mechanic. That's the bigger thing, is the atmosphere. And
Yeah.
not just the atmosphere of the level, like the area design, which is amazing, the mood that they set between that and the music, and like this weird, like somehow they're like infinitely spawning and fighting each other, but it's still like so lonely because you can tell that they're just like
They've
gone
been
to the
doing this for fucking
right.
an eternity, and
And
yeah.
I yeah that and the lore around it and just what the Abyss Walkers were, like that's got to be my favorite, at least up.
Yeah, and their move set is so unique, so it's so fun to like to figure out the timings for
And
like
it's.
what your openings are, because they move around in ways that are like they're familiar to kind of Artorias in Dark Souls 1, but they're still like their equipment's a little different, so they move a little more slicker, and
Yeah,
it's
it's more of
pretty.
a like Artorias was like a really fast but still kind of a weighty
Yeah.
knight, and they're more like fencers. I always pictured them as like the just the real classic, like when you think Victorian era, like fancy like fencing like masters or something like that, or
Yeah.
Zorro-esque, I guess. Although I don't like Zorro, but yeah, that was a really cool fight. And I mean, we could do a 5-hour-long show probably on Dark Souls bosses,
My
but
favorite Dark Souls bosses for sure. But yeah, it's so it sucks that like that second boss fight, I felt like it was just a waste of space. And it was like it kind of felt like, oh, they're out of ideas. So
yeah, and that's what.
I was a little worried
And
at that point.
it starts with it. So that's what I could see. I was watching your tweets, like not like live, like I was sitting at my desk just waiting for you to tweet about it. But when I was going through, I could see them, you know, as they're playing out. And you could tell it's kind of like getting you like the feeling like, oh, this is the final DLC, the final chapter, whatever. And they're going to like go down this road. Like,
yeah, what the fuck? I mean, and my tweet, like, I stand by what I critique that boss fight for. Any other negative tweets I might have said about it, like, you also kind of have to take with a grain of salt because I'm just kind of venting. Like, those tweets happen as that shit happens to me. You know, and I have to also, you know, in defense of some of the stuff that was giving me problems early on, going from Neo back to Dark Souls 3 is really hard to do. Because you're so used to the speed and like the ability to recover stamina and like just hit shit so many times and recover, and like the pace of the combat is so different that like to go back to Neo and like I spent the entire DLC just being like, how the fuck is my like Dark Souls 3 character so slow? How can he only?
Which is funny because I think you feel faster in 3 than any of the other two.
Yeah, and I went for a lighter build, for sure. So, yeah, that was really fucked up.
Yeah, that's what I'm wondering now, too, because I think I went with a pretty tanky build in 3. I'd have to go back and see if I still have any of my...
See, I intentionally went with, like, a lighter katana style, too, because I always go with, like, kind of the tanky knight build in these games, and so I wanted to do something different and see if I could actually beat a Dark Souls game without... you know, doing the knight and the shield sort of style. And you can. Another thing I should mention is they recommend that you're like level, if you're on just regular new game and not like a new game plus run, they recommend that you're level like 125 to do this DLC. And I was like level 99 when I started it. So there is a chance that I was just painfully underleveled, but I never had to really grind in Dark Souls 3 or even in that first DLC. So and I didn't really have to grind for this. I eventually beat everything. It might have been harder than it needed to be. I don't know. It just seemed ridiculous to me. Like, you need to be 20 more levels than you reasonably will be. Yeah. It's like, fuck that. I'm just going to go fucking do it.
Just fucking do it, damn it.
Just fucking do it, man. I don't know what voice that was, but he's my new character. just fucking do it. So the third boss is the optional boss in the game. And I ended up liking this one a lot more than I thought I would, because it is a dragon fight. And especially in Dark Souls 2, but really in all the Dark Souls games, these games have not figured out how to give a dragon fight a good camera. They're usually all pretty miserable, and this one isn't really much of an exception. But I still had a lot of fun with it, and it's a pretty cool setup where like the dragon is doing the kind of typical Dark Souls thing where you get to an area and it just burns like the entire bridge that you need to cross, and you gotta like you gotta time how you get across it, but you also have to like drop down on ledges before it fucking lights you on fire. And like, it's a really, we've kind of all been there with these dragons, but like the story of this dragon seems really interesting, because his name's like Midir the Dark Eater, and he's just this dragon that for over like all the ages of Dark Souls has just, his sole job has been like consuming darkness so it doesn't like destroy the world. So he's just all fucking corrupted and scary. But you get to a point where you kind of fight him on this bridge, or you can just run past him. Like I said, it is an optional fight. But if you fight him on this bridge, like you think you're about to hit the killing blow and you like knock him off the bridge and he just like plummets. And you have to like jump down a particular pit that's pretty well hidden, but you jump down and you like go into his lair and you have to like do the real fight from there. And it was like one of those fucked up, like he's killing me in one hit. I'm putting on every stupid piece of random ass armor I have so I don't get like killed by the fire immediately. Just trying shit, and like it kind of got back to what I liked, where it's like that initial feeling of a boss of like, how the fuck am I ever supposed to do this? And then just you keep throwing yourself at that wall until you start realizing like, oh, you can dodge that attack. You can dodge that. And then like, if you dodge this, you can get a, you know, free hit on the head there. And the more I did it, I was like, okay, I think I could do it if I summon people. You know, I think if I summon a little bit of help, it was almost impossible to get people into my game. Like, I think everybody
hates that fight.
Everybody wanted help for that fight. Yeah. And it was kind of fucked up because like the first person I summoned, we got him really close, and then my helper died. And then he got into a whole new attack pattern that I couldn't, like, I was not prepared for at all. And then I just summoned people, and you never want to shit on free help, but these people had no idea how to fight this fucking dragon. They had no experience. Like, they just were running up to the tell and just like, I'll just hit this forever. And it's like, that's not going to work. It's going to fucking spin around and like murder you in one hit. Just,
but we've been programmed through like all these games that if something's big and has a tail, like position yourself by it. Yeah.
Yeah, that's the thing. Like, this dragon's tail, like, he moves it a lot, so it's actually kind of hard to hit the tail. It's better to get one or two hits on the head and then, like, back off than to try to... Like, that's the weird thing. Most dragon fights, you want to get up close and, like, hit the feed and, you know, dodge stomps and stuff, and this dragon doesn't really let you do that. So it's the weird sort of dragon fight where you have to fight him at a distance, which plays right into his goddamn fire attacks, so you have to learn how to dodge those, too. But it was pretty rewarding. And then like after a while, I was just like, fuck it. None of these people are helping me. So I did it solo. And that was a pretty, like, the camera was a pain in the ass, but like learning that fight and being able to beat it on my own was pretty satisfying. And you get a really awesome katana for it. Or like the,
I think you've always used katanas in the games, don't you?
No, I always went like long sword and shield.
Oh, huh.
This is the first time
that you used like the washing pole or something. And
I did in this one. In Dark Souls 2, it was just sword and shield, and in Dark Souls 1, it was definitely sword and shield because I wasn't mentally prepared to do anything else. But the katana you get for this one, like the special move, like all the katanas are like, they start with like you sheath the sword. But there's like the heavy attack is just like a fucking barrage of slashes, which is pretty awesome. And then I got that backwards. That's the light attack. And then the heavier attack, like you shoot a shockwave from your sword, and it's so cool. And turns out really fucking helpful for the final boss.
Does the shockwave like degrade the sword? I know a lot of the times the weapons in those games that like do those moves, like it'll break the, like it only has so much of that in it, and then they like break.
No, I didn't have any like durability problems. Like it's not that tough of a shockwave, honestly. But it is good, like, if you're in a spot where you have an opening, but you don't have the distance. Which brings me to the final fight, which is one of the best fights in Dark Souls. Like, in my opinion, I loved this fucking duel so much. Cause you're in just like this wasteland, and like the dude who kind of like the two DLCs of Dark Souls 3 are story wise tied together, and which I didn't expect because Dark Souls is usually pretty sporadic about where things are set, and like they don't really care about making certain things connect, or at least not connect in obvious ways. So like the guy you fight is like a guy you were introduced to like at the very beginning of this sort of DLC arc, but he's like completely fucking changed and like driven crazy, and he's like very like beastly. So like the first time you kind of have to go to him and find him in this sort of fucked up apocalyptic wasteland, which looks like they do a good job of presenting it as a big area, but it's actually pretty straightforward. But every time you die to him after that, you come into like the wasteland, you go through the fog door, and you see him just fucking charging you like a goddamn animal in the distance. And it's so scary because you don't even have time to shoot an arrow at him because he's just coming up on you.
Nice.
But yeah, it's a 3-stage boss fight. And it was one of those things. It took me about 2 hours, which I know a lot of people are going to be like, that fight's fucking easy. What's wrong with you? But I really didn't want to summon help for it. Because like the first time I did it, it was like, it is hard, but I think it's beatable. I think I could do it on my own. And see, I wanted to stick with it.
And it's funny because different fights in those games, like we've all got our own kind of play style and tendencies. And what ends up happening is like fights that for some of us, like some of the fights that I've had the most problems with, you're like, oh, that's straightforward. And then some of the ones that like are notoriously,
did fine.
I strolled in and like one or two, not shotted, but you know, one or two attempts. And now, of course, part of that is because I almost always summon the NPC help if I can, or in three, I always summon people if I could. Yeah. But it's just certain fights lend to your playstyle, and other ones very much don't. Losing my mind against Gwyn in Dark Souls 1, because that was a very much fucking pay attention to what he's going to do, and you better react correctly. And
that is kind of the story with this one, but I love that shit. Yeah. You know, that's what I, you know,
but you're adore more observant about Dark Souls than me, boxes. And you think your toolbox is bigger too, because my toolbox is okay, either roll or swing. And you're like, hey, idiot, you can run away. It's like, oh, yeah, I always forget that. Like, it's so counterintuitive.
Well, I mean, that's really the toolbox you have for this fight. It's just about, like, it becomes harder to dodge everything this guy does to you. Because he has this giant sword, but like I said, he's coming at you in a very, like, kind of beastly way in the first phase. And he's just sort of, like, he's throwing his entire body into every slice. And it's... he throws a lot of shit that like you don't, that kind of catches you out of rhythm. So I kind of figured out as I was playing it more that like the best thing to do is like, yeah, if he gets right up on you, you know, dodge it as best as you can. And then, you know, you probably can get a free hit in, but really you want him to do like kind of his longer range stuff. Cause it's a lot easier to dodge that. Cause he does these charge moves and like these leaping moves where he tries to like smash down on you. So it's easier to just dodge roll that shit. So you do that and you get like the first third of his health. And that's when like the real shit starts and he becomes a real motherfucker after that.
Why don't these bosses ever get easier as they hit these, as you like,
rip them apart? Yeah. I'm sure there were some bosses like, if I really racked my brain about it, where that actually was the case. But, this one, like, he'll just pull out, like, a rapid-fire crossbow and just spray you. And if, like, the first shot hits you, then you're fucked. Like, it'll take almost all your health away if you're not, embered. And, yeah, like, but... he has like this fucking demonic shit, like following every slice he does. And he's like, after you get the second third down, he starts summoning goddamn like lightning that just randomly appears on the fucking map. So you're like having this epic duel in this wasteland with lightning, like crashing around you guys. It's like, as far as like a thematic sort of final fight, it's amazing. And in terms of just like the type of combat I like, where you have to learn these dodges, you have to learn when your openings are, you have to learn to not get greedy and manage your stamina more than you want to hit the guy. I love all that shit. Yeah. So
one of the other things I'm terrible at is this. So she's like, I got an opening, swing, 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 swing. And you can sometimes, that was what was giving me fits with Gwyn in the first Dark Souls, is that you can get away with all those swings. A lot of times you can't, and then you just learn from like being smacked in the face when you try to get your third swing in. That one, yeah, you could get all the swings in, but what happens is that leaves you with zero stamina. And then,
yeah. But, yeah, the Gwyn fight is, Like, for me, I found that fight, like, really, really easy. Because well, it's just how I play those games.
And that's what Dark Souls is so good about. If you're smarter than me and you're an actual student and you learn things about teaching you, like, management of everything. Positioning, your attack windows, your dodges. It's just...
Well, that was kind of what I was like. It was that part of me where it was like, all right, you are probably under-leveled for this fight. But, you know, some people would probably have been in my position and been like, oh, well, you need to, you know, go grind and level up your stamina or use some of these boss souls that you never spent. And to me, it was like, no, I just need to learn that opening only gives me enough room for one slash and then I have to dodge out. You know, and knowing where to dodge, too. Like, I like learning that shit where, like, I, you know, an hour and a half in, you know, I have to, like, I'm shaking with, like I can't fucking, I'm so tense and, like, I want to beat this guy. Like, I had to take a 5-minute break to just, like, walk away from my computer and just, like, okay, you know. What have I learned so far? You know, like, I know if he slashes this way, if you actually dodge into him, I can, you know, get two hits, you know, and then everything else I kind of have a good timing for. And then there was just that, like, last quarter of the fight where everything goes crazy and he's, like, flying around. And it's just that thing of, like, you know, good fucking luck. Hopefully you have enough Estus Flasks and you time your healing correctly. Because you have to time healing... almost more than you have to time your attacks. Because, like, if the guy is close enough to you and sees you that you're taking a drink, he just chops your head off.
Yep. Goodbye.
So, yeah, it's a really fucking cool fight. To me, that was worth the DLC alone. But, I mean, I got the season pass, so I'm, you know, I'm of a higher tier, I guess, than some of you other Dark Souls people out there. It's a shame. But yeah, the Ring City is pretty good overall. I liked it. And it was cool to have, you know, one sort of epic fight to sort of cap everything off.
Without giving away any specifics, does it do anything more to kind of bring closure to what, like, Dark Souls is, like, as a universe? Or is it more just a closure to that DLC arc?
Kind of both. Because the DLC arc sort of concerns the idea of, like, I mean, I talked about it in the thing I wrote today that, you know, I would need a whiteboard in, like, days probably to describe even half the plot of Dark Souls. But it does sort of answer a question of, like, how can all this be going on in the same world?
Right.
And... yeah, I mean, it doesn't confirm any answers for you, but it makes you think, like, maybe it doesn't. Like, maybe the whole balance of light and dark sort of transcends worlds. And because the whole plot line of this DLC is, like, basically about finding, like, the first Ariandel, the frozen world, is a world in a painting.
Right.
But they're going through their own sort of crisis of, like, the flame and letting darkness take over and... they're ruled by a tyrant who doesn't want to rekindle the flame, which is what, you know, everybody tells you should do in these games. But meanwhile, you know, there's somebody, an important character who only gets introduced in this DLC, who's actually, like, trying to paint an entirely new world. And she needs, you know, she needs Dark Souls shit to make it happen. So it's... you know, I couldn't tell you the answers. Like, it's that would be completely not in the Dark Souls style for them to ever concretely answer anything.
I would have left her to zoom out, and it's just like some guy wakes up from a dream, and it was all just a dream. Like, just give it the cheapest possible fucking, like.
I would love it if it was just like the Witness ending. I don't know if you're familiar with that, but it's just like a developer waking up in a fucking on a couch and, like, kind of like, wow, that was fucked up.
Yeah, something like that. Like something that has nothing to do with any of, like, the, like, volumes of lore that they've written, but something that's also cheap and not satisfying. Just like, it's all in a snow globe and it's just on some guy's desk and it's like the end.
Yeah, totally. Fucking, they could probably get away with that and people would still be making, like, hour-long YouTube videos trying to break down every part.
How does this fit into the Souls universe? Is this just another... And I'm not making fun of those Souls videos. Those are some of my favorite things to... actually what's gotten me... Like, I've never been a big online video consumer. Like, I just don't watch stuff online much, and the Souls stuff has kind of changed that now. And I watch more, like, other stuff now because it's kind of like...
Open that door.
Gotten whatever. But Souls totally. Lore is like amazing to just watch and listen
that's,
to.
And that's such a cool thing about the series, I think, is like not only is it a community effort in terms of the gameplay, you know, with messages and, you know, help and PvP and stuff. It's a community effort from the storyline to figure pieces out and theorize and discuss things. And like, in that respect, it's one of the best, I think, pieces of fiction in all of games, because it's just so fun to, like, speculate and hear other people's speculations on what, you know, what means what and how does all this connect. And, like, I'm a huge fan of that. So, The Ring City is pretty good. If you have Dark Souls 3, you should probably play it, because that's it. that's all you're getting.
I've just got this feeling, because I know I wouldn't be shocked for like a and I don't know because I don't know how the story ends, but like a Bloodborne 2 follow-up, just from a commercial standpoint, because that game did so well.
They kind of said that, like, you know, we're not, like Miyazaki said, like, you know, I'm not going to go out of my way to not do a Dark Souls sort of style game.
I
don't want to.
Well, they're already working on something, so you know it's not like, oh, we're sitting back and we're going to decide. They've already announced that they've got another project, but that's basically what the announcement was. It's like, we've got something different coming. Yeah. But you just kind of get the feeling, and I get it. You need a break, like, or you just want to break.
Five games of this shit.
You got to imagine at some point through the development of all this, he had another idea, like, hey, I would like to make this. And it's like, now I'm going to fucking do that. But I kind of get that. And like I said, this is just complete speculation because I don't know anything about the team, the guy. I don't have any special news that like I said, literally, they just said, we're working on something. Yeah. But I just kind of get the feeling that it not only will it not be Souls, but I don't think it'll be a Souls like. I think it feels to me like they're ready to, because they've done so many other type of games, and I know they were big into the mech games. I forget which ones they were.
All right, I don't remember. Let me
check. And it's funny because they've got my impression of them was that they're pretty terrible games, but the people that like them love them.
The Armored Core.
Yeah, Armored Core. I kept wanting to say Wild Arms, and that's way off.
Here's the fucked up thing, is like, I never played Armored Core. The thing I knew from software for before the Souls series was Enchanted Arms, and fuck that game. So, like, I was kind of like, how the fuck did they end up, like, making something that ended up being one of my favorite series ever?
And that's kind of what's scary, is if it's like, well, we need a break, we want to go to... something else, and it's like, yeah, but your other track record's kind of like,
but I mean, you know, it's I wouldn't want them to do it forever, honestly.
No, I mean, it cheapens it. It's like the TV shows that, like, and I still watch them all, but I grew up diehard Simpsons fan. Like, I could probably recite seasons 1 through 10, like every script word for word, not quite that much, but. But that show is like 30 years old now, not quite. But every time you watch it now, I still watch it, but I'm watching it like, why is this still a thing? And that mean when it does eventually go away, it goes away on a sour note. So, I mean, there's nothing wrong with taking a break or even ending something like on your terms. But it's sad.
But, yeah.
The good news is it's not like we have a void left where there's nothing else to play. There might not be anything else that's particularly Souls-like, but there's tons of great stuff out there.
Like I sort of ended that piece on, it was just like, you know, I think we're going to feel the influence of the Soul series for, you know, probably many years before we get another... like official sort of Soul style game from software. So I can live with that. You know, if anything, I need a break probably. after Neo and then this shit. I mean, I'm going crazy, man. It's a dangerous rabbit hole to like be a fucking fan of these games.
Yeah. So anything, what's like next for you? You finished Horizon last week. You finished
the Dark Souls DLC, probably Nier. Give that an actual, a real go, but
the college try, the old college. Yeah. It's supposed to be good. I mean, I know you were having issues with it, but,
I mean, the patch seemed to fix my problems. The
hack.
The user mod fixed it. They did officially respond and say we're looking into that stuff, but then that's all they said. So, like, hey, guy already looked into it. Yeah. He fixed it for
maybe
you.
Maybe that's what they mean. Maybe they're contacting him, like, how much do we have to pay you for this fix?
Yeah, maybe just pay him because he did it for you. But yeah, I mean, that's not really why I haven't jumped into it yet. It was just sort of, you know, it's been a busy time after Zelda, Horizon, Dark Souls DLC. It's just, you know, it's like once you jump into the next thing, you're kind of, you know, you're pot committed at that point, and then it's stressful. So, which video games shouldn't be. But they kind of are right now at this beginning of the year. Mostly I play solitaire and try to work up the energy to play the next thing.
And that's what I noticed you playing NBA, whatever, 17 or whichever one you have the other day. And that's what I've been trying to get away from NHL. And it's not, I don't want to say it's, we talked about it last week. It's not a very good hockey game in that it's not fucking changed anything for 5 years. It's not bad. There's nothing broken about it, but it's not like I keep playing it because it's like, wow, this is the greatest sports experience I've ever had in video game form. But it's more so, it's not stressful at all, and I can sit down and play one or two games or play 15 games, whichever. I did start, and I'm kind of on the fence whether it be my first and last dive into it, The Last Guardian on Saturday, I think Friday night, maybe over the weekend.
Yeah,
and I played it for a couple an hour and a half, 2 hours, I don't know. I started it pretty late, and then it was one of those things before you know it, it's like 2 o'clock, and you're like, what time did I start? What day is this? What is my name? And it's exactly like you said, and from the little bit, like I never went away out of my way to read reviews on it, but. It's like such a cool, like I love Trico.
Trico, whatever Trico, you want.
Yeah. Love that. It's such a neat character. It's got like we spent like a half hour talking about dogs and our like love hate thing with dogs, and they capture that so well because there's so much.
I hate that son of a bitch.
Right. Well, it's like at times you're like, oh man, look how cute he is, and oh, he's so great, and oh, he's in pain. I want to help it, and then other times you're like, get the fuck over here, stop.
It's like, doing God damn it, asshole! It's just a mirror. Move.
Right. And then he'll just randomly like, I'm gonna bite your head off. It's like, yeah, just like a real dog. But I like the story, and the visuals are nice and the story's cool. It's just not, I always use this word and then people jump down my throat, but it's not fun to play. It's just not a joy to play. It's aggravating to play.
Yeah, see, I saw your tweet about that, and like it was like, yeah, I would agree with that. Yeah, I mean, I like the game. But no, it's not. It's a game you play for the moments it delivers.
Right.
But it's not a. But it's. I mean, it's clunky. It's awkward.
And then so far the puzzles, I assume they get more involved, or at least more you have to think about them. But in the first couple hours of the game, there's never been a part where I've really. Well, there's been a few parts where I didn't know what to do because visually it wasn't clear. You have to just kind of like. Yeah. Run around until you happen to like, oh wait, there's a ledge over there. But for the most part, it's straightforward. It's just the puzzles take forever to do because you move so fucking slow, or just clunky and awkward.
I mean, and you have to, like, I kind of benefited, I think, because I've played Ico, I've played Shadow of the Colossus, and they all have kind of elements of that, especially Ico. and it's just like you have to kind of prepare yourself for that. Like, this is going to be a bit of a, like, mechanically it's going to be a bit of a slog to, like, you know, progress in this game. But there is something about, like, when the puzzles do get a little more complex and you figure out, like, what Trico's trying to tell you it wants to do, and, like, when you're trying to tell Trico what you want him to do, I think those moments make up for it a lot by the end. And by the end, you do get that kind of emotional attachment to this story and to this weird fucking dog thing that's helped you the entire game, or hurt you in some cases. I think it's a good game in that respect, but you kind of always have to, like, be sort of mentally prepared that, like, these games are kind of clumsy. And even, like, Shadow is the one that everyone holds up as a masterpiece, and I, in some ways, I agree, but it's also, like, there's elements of playing Shadow where I'm like, God, this is fucking miserable. Like, just let me stab the head. Like, quit shaking.
Right. And I just pulled, because out of curiosity, I'm like, well, because it's one of those where it's like, I could probably suffer through this. It can't be that long. And it looks like the average time to play through it's between like 11 and 13 hours, which feels way too long for that type of game to me.
And I think I talked about it when I played it. I thought the game was going to end many hours before it did, and it would just keep going. And it was like, God damn it.
Yeah. That's one of my biggest pet peeves in games.
I mean, unlike other games that kind of drag on, and it's like, just when the credits finally roll, you're just like, finally, fuck. Like, this one, like, it managed to kind of rope me back in a little bit more.
Of it's narrative problems, not so much that you get sick of it, but, like, if they, like you said, if they make it feel like it's about to wrap up and then it just keeps going, that gets mentally exhausting, because it, you're just waiting for something that never comes.
And it really feels like this game kind of just keeps hitting you with the same, you know, emotional gut punch, but it never, like, fully, like, it never fully commits to it. So there's, like, a certain point where, like, just by the end of the game, it's like, oh my God, kill the fucking bird dog or don't. Like, just quit with this fucking teasing shit. Like, give me the ending. And, you know, and when they do, honestly, like, that, it's a really, I think it's a really good ending. But you have to kind of, it is a game you kind of have to endure a little bit, you know, and I was a little more willing to do that because I've been following the game since they announced it. I really wanted to know what it would be. I was way more invested in it than I would be if it was just like some other fucking game that randomly came out. You know, but people have done crazier things. They played Duke Nukem Forever. So they wanted to know what the fuck that was.
It was a good investment.
Nope.
To buy it full price, pre-ordered.
Nope.
No.
It was a bad investment.
It was. Probably some of my worst money.
You got your two words there confused, son.
I learned. That's why games like Aliens, Colonial Marines, I rented.
There you go. Yeah. That's
a, but, so yeah, Last Guardian is really the only new thing that I've played this week. And new to me, I mean, obviously, and it's probably one of the newer games I've played recently, having only come out in December, only 4 months old instead of.
Yeah. I mean, that's relatively fresh. It's Rotten Tomatoes, relatively fresh. Did we want to talk about this Persona 5 shit?
I don't know a whole lot about it other than just what I've, like, gathered from Twitter, but.
So they put out a statement saying, basically saying, if you stream or do like a video let's play of all the game, they will send like copy ID claims to your thing and possibly strikes on your YouTube account. Cool. And
that seems smart.
Well, when you consider that a large part of Persona 4's popularity came from the Giant Bomb guys playing all of it, like, I wouldn't know what Persona was if those guys hadn't done that playthrough. I never would have checked it out. I would have just kind of dismissed it as another anime JRPG that I probably wouldn't play. So it's this weird disconnect from their own fucking audience. But yeah, they put out that statement and they said like it was worse because they were like, well, you can stream the game up to this point in the game time, up to the month of July or whatever, but we don't want people like getting spoiled. Like we don't want to spoil the story. And my whole point, like I've kind of been on a rant about this for like 2 days, is then don't make a fucking game. Don't make anything.
Yeah, because what's stopping me from like talking to my friend and being like, oh, and then this happens and then this happened? I mean,
yeah.
If you're somebody that's going to watch a game, spoil the story, and then not buy it because of that, you weren't going to buy the game in the first place.
Right. And like I responded to somebody today, like they were talking about like, well, I don't agree with Atlus doing it because like they are an example of like streaming and stuff actually serving as really good promotion. But there are smaller developers who they get treated like shit because they feel the same way about streaming because they get financially hurt. And I don't deny that's true, but you cannot, like, there's no clear way to say like, all right, this viewer equals a lost sale.
Right.
You have no way of knowing that. And it was fucking pissing me off because like I hate this argument because it's just the same like rental argument we were having like at the beginning of the show when we first started, when David Jaffe was talking about that shit. And it's just you can't. And as a person, I think David Jaffe is great, but yeah, I didn't agree with him on this.
Well, we've talked about it's just to interject a completely different tangent, but I think we spent the first year of our show with me ranting about
arguing about shit he said on Twitter.
And then like you said, it's funny because over the years, it's like, you know what, as a person, I think he's one of the cooler, like he handles things for the most part better than a lot of devs do that are on, although he's gotten a lot less active on social media.
Probably for the best.
Yeah, I think a lot of those guys realize you have to, but anyway, yeah, but that said, I still disagree with a lot of his views.
Yeah, and and this especially just, it always pisses me off because I like watching streams. It's entertainment. And to like say that it's to like combat spoilers, like, no, you don't give you want sales and you think you're losing sales by people watching the stream, and you have no way of proving that.
And Atlus is such a weird fucking company to me because they go back and forth. They're one of the, they've got to be the biggest import developer for just Japanese games, because that's basically what they do, is they're responsible for bringing a lot of these Japanese games to the U.S. and, you know, getting them either voice-overed or just translated and that kind of thing. I would imagine that they're the single biggest publisher for that in that specific niche. And on some days they come across as like the most fan friendly, like we're in touch with our fans, we get it.
I think a lot of that is just like they make games that people like, but that doesn't necessarily mean you're like CD Projekt Red, you know?
Yeah. But I mean, I've even watched like their interactions with a lot of people because they're also fairly accessible on the PR front. But they go back and forth, and they go back and forth with their fans, like you said, fans, and they do get a lot of free bonus points because it's like, here's this game that we never thought we'd get to play. Oh, you're bringing it over. Woohoo, you're our hero. And then they do something like this, and all of a sudden everybody's like, what the fuck is wrong with you? And I agree. No sense.
And I should clarify, like me and my brother were talking about this and we're pretty much in agreement. And our exact words were, this shit sucks. When we can afford to, we will still play the shit out of Persona 5. So we're not putting our money where our mouth is on this, really. The truth is, I don't have an interest in watching Persona streams. Those are games play for myself.
Exactly.
But I have watched plenty of story-driven games get streamed and said, I want to play that for myself. And there have been a lot of games that I've watched streamed that it's like, I'm never going to play that anyway. So I'll watch someone play it and see.
I did that.
See their unique playthrough of it.
I did that. And it wasn't even a playthrough. It was like a story through for The Last of Us. And it's not because I think the game's bad. I just know it's a game that at the time I didn't even have a PlayStation 4 yet. And I knew by the time I'd get one, it would be so far down on the backlog that it's just not the type of game that I'm just like dying to wake up and play. So sure. It's not like, oh, this thing is out here. I got the whole story. I know what happened from beginning to end. I didn't get to experience because I didn't watch a Let's Play, which I could do. But I still, you hit all the major plot points and cutscenes, and no, I didn't buy the game. But I didn't not buy the game because I got to watch it. I would have never bought that game. I would have just not known the story. And then you can make this argument. You say, even if you try to argue, say, well, you lost that sale because you would have had to buy the game to experience it and you just watched it anyway. Well, the reason I watched it is because they announced The Last of Us 2, which I'll be in a much better position to play when it comes out if I decide I want to. But sure. I wasn't going to play 2 without playing 1. So then you can
Or at least knowing what happened.
Well, right, on 1. Right.
And there's, and that's the other thing is like this person who I responded to, they brought up that dragon cancer, who they have the well documented like problem with Let's Plays and shit. Here's the truth about that dragon cancer. That dragon cancer was a weird fucking little game in a very competitive medium. There's way too many games out there that anybody who saw that didn't say, like, oh, I have to play that Dragon Cancer.
Well, and it came out at a tough time where there was a lot of those games coming out just right then, too. Like,
right. And once again, the people watching that Dragon Cancer are not the same people who want to play that Dragon Cancer. It's you have to have some self-awareness about your product. If your product is one that could be so easily financially hurt. Like, this is going to sound completely dickish because I don't want to discourage people from going after their visions. But on some level, you have to take responsibility. If you're going to take such a hit because the biggest part of your game is like what you're watching, then you need to, you need to rethink that's like, where they're completely, what you're doing in your.
And nobody wanted to say, and I didn't, I hesitated to talk about it because that game, the story is, gut-wrenching, but the actual story, like the real-life humans behind it in that story is, it's very touching and it's awesome and it's sad and it's important, but the game itself sucked. The playable parts of that, that's why watching it hurt it so bad, because the only interesting part of that game was that story. Right. But everything about anytime you had control, there'd be these little mini-games you'd have to do, like the one I remember the most was you were doing laps around like a hospital hallway. It was just a circular, square, like you'd go down and turn and down and turn and just not even like an interesting shape, just a circle basically. And you had to like collect balloons and avoid objects. And it was so floaty. And like, if you hit an object, it didn't really do anything. There was really no point to it. It was just bad. It wasn't, again, I know this word's not how everybody uses it, but it wasn't fun. It wasn't interesting to play. It would have gone across much better as a virtual documentary. Like, maybe we don't have the skill set to make a movie, but we're going to make this entirely non-playable experience that you can watch.
Yeah, like an animated documentary or something. Right. Like, and that's the thing. Like, and I'm open to even, like, I'm not even, like, against these, like, heavy narrative games where you have minimum input. But you have to take into consideration, like, what field are you in? If you're going to lose so much because somebody streamed their playthrough of your game, if somebody's going to watch that and be like, well, fuck, I guess I don't need to play it because that's all there is, at what point is that your fault?
Right.
Like, at what point is that you made a game that doesn't have an appeal for the modern age? And the modern age is streaming. People want to watch games sometimes more than they want to play them, And like, if you can't get around that, if you can't make a game where, like, I can, there's tons of games that I can point to that, like, they've spoiled the, and I watched the entire game from start to finish, and I still said, well, I have to play it. Like I still right. really want to play it for myself. The other thing I keep hearing is like, well, they have the right to do it. And legally, yeah, they have the right. But I would argue, you know, at what point do you, like, when I buy a game, why is my unique playthrough of that game not, like, why can't that be on some level my own content?
Well, yeah. Well, that's usually the distinction. That's the distinction that Twitch and YouTube have used to actually get around these copyright things in the past is if you're streaming a game, I know you have a lot more issues and people that stream and do way more video content than us are more familiar with this. But if I literally just play a game, I have no me talking on the microphone, you know, no microphone, no picture of me up in the corner. It's just me playing a game and all you get is that. That's a lot harder to get past on like YouTube, not so much on Twitch, but on YouTube without getting strikes. But once you, you know, if you've got me playing a game and the whole time I'm talking about the game and our anecdotes about dogs and whatever the hell we talk about, that becomes me, you know. Theoretically, you're watching the video for the person and not necessarily just what they're playing.
Yeah, I mean, like, one thing that's going to get hit by this is speedruns, because they're speedruns aren't there to fucking, you know, show just up to fucking July 7th in game time. They show the entire game. And you don't, but you're not watching that to take in the entire game. You're watching that to see somebody skillfully navigate a game, to do things with a game that you would never think to do in a casual playthrough. And so that stuff gets thrown out the fucking window because they're going to show boss fights that Atlus just decided they don't want seen.
Well, and that was going to be my other question. It sounds like there was no, like, when you bought the game, it's not like real big ahead of time, like, by the way, you can only stream the first.
Well, I mean, if you buy the game, the share button just doesn't work. They just switch that off. But if you have like a thing that, like, you know, an outside streaming device, then like, that's when they go after your videos, depending on what content you put up. But I heard they might have updated that, so like you can do some things with the share, but it was like you couldn't do screenshots. It's like, man, fuck you.
Well, I'm not defending it, but I can see it, you know, as a developer, it would kind of suck. It'd be like writing a book and having somebody buy your Cliff Notes instead. And it's like, well, I couldn't like, see like I'm going to sue you. There? Yeah, well, it's them. I'm just saying I get that as the developer, that's not a fun feeling, but that doesn't mean you should. And then for like I said, Atlus, they're a niche publisher that has based their whole business model on bringing games from Japan to the West. And part of probably the majority of their success has been based on fandom. So then to go, I just don't even get like,
to me, this is the biggest thing about it. Okay. Like, cause I'm certain I've seen the review scores for it. People love Persona 5.
Right. And they love 4 and 3 and it wasn't like it's this, about it,
but here's the thing. You're not going to have a Persona game every year. And unless you think all the weird kind of turn-based JRPG games you're going to fucking throw out over the years, like you really, and I stress it with Atlus, I would stress it even more with some of these small developers who are thinking like, yeah, why are they wrong for, you know, defending their product? Okay, whatever you feel about streaming, you feel like you're losing out on sales, whatever. But here's the reality. You look like such assholes when you do this to your fan base. And it's not whether you are being an asshole or not, that is the perception. And when you're in a business, that's just as damning as whether or not it's true.
Right. Oh, I mean, yeah, especially in the internet era.
And especially when you're like a niche fucking developer or you're a small-time developer, like you really need to like communicate with your audience way better than this. Cause like the way I phrased it yesterday is like, if they had just said like, we really would emphasize like, you know, please, you know, experience this story for yourself. We put a lot of work into it. We think it's some of the best work we ever did. Like that, would get over way fucking better than this, because now people are really like upset, and yeah. and now people well, are gonna like go out of their way to spoil it.
Like, I could see being upset. I kind of had that joke tweet because it's obviously not real, and I would never think this way about any game. But like, and say, oh, I spent my last $60, but I'll finally this will be the game that makes me a successful streamer. And then you get home and put it in, it's like, what the fuck? Nope. I can't stream it because there's no heads up on it either. That's the part that, but the absolute weirdest thing, there are games out there where you could kind of try to make that argument, like that Dragon Cancer about streaming hurts it, blah, blah, blah. I think this is one of the video games out of all, not just Atlus's games, but out of all of them that streaming couldn't possibly hurt and could only help them.
Yeah, like, well, it helped them with Persona 4.
Right.
You know, it was huge for Persona 4.
And it's weird because it's from what I gather, I only played 2 and I never finished it because it's a really long fucking game, like most JRPGs. But, and a lot of it's very personal. Like, I can watch you play it. My experience may be different because a lot of it has to do with how you build the relationships between all the different characters.
And that's the other thing. Like, a unique playthrough, in my opinion, like, I watch a lot of videos without commentary and stuff, and it's just the game. I'm still watching a unique playthrough of that game. How they navigate the game, like, you can't, like, people keep comparing it, like, well, you can't just stream a movie, and it's like, well, if your game is like a movie, I think you already fucked up.
Yeah, the making of a movie.
Yeah, you're like, a game, so much of it is on the player, how the player, like, if a guy's having a fucking huge fit on a Persona boss, that is unique to that moment. You know, that is not like, oh, this is how the developer wanted you to experience this. Like, this is the player's experience of their game, you know? And so I never like when developers and publishers try to get involved with how a player is going to enjoy their game. That they pay fucking $60 for. So yeah, that's my opinion. I was way fucking angrier about it this morning. Like, on some level I do sympathize, because there is a sense of like, yeah, I'm sure there are some people who are going to be stupid and like, oh, I'm interested in this game, let's see what it's about. Oh, I know part of the story, I'm done. But you know, like, that, you can't avoid that.
No.
The best thing you can do is just focus on making the, like, best, most engaging game possible. And, you know, and then let the chips fall where they are, because it's the internet age. Spoilers are out there. You know, if I want to know the plot to Persona 5 and never fucking, like, put any effort into it, I'm going to get it. I'm going to get the videos. Those are going to be out there. Like, it's...
Well, you could just go to GameStop and talk to the guy that played it there. Like, I mean...
I have been watching Let's Plays since, like, 2005. 2005 or 2006. This is not an old this is not a new conversation. People have been trying to figure out how to control this since the first person was like, I'm going to record some of this shit. Like, you can't.
Well, they started it anyway. They used to encourage us taking pictures of the screen and like mailing them in to, I remember Pitfall for Atari had that, like, you'd send in your, if you got to the end, take a Polaroid of your high score and send it in. And if it was high enough, it would like go out in their newsletter. Like, so they started it. It's their fault.
Yeah, I mean, and I don't like it, but even Neo blocked cutscenes and stuff, and I thought that was weird and kind of dumb, but I was more okay with that than like, okay, I understand, like, you don't want people to see like your fucking final cutscene or this particular story cutscene. Like, I understand that shit. You know, it might mean you chop up Persona 5 a bit, but like, I would respect that more than if you were just like saying, like, if you were just doing this, like, well, you be careful what you record, because then, well, if you fuck up, we'll come for you. It's like, you know, how about you just decide, you know, how about, just keep the share button broken. Like, don't even threaten me. Like, because that shit is like, you cannot afford to have that animosity with your fans. Yeah. In any sort of thing that, like, your popularity kind of depends on how much fucking money you make. And like I said, Persona 5 will probably be fine. But the next thing Atlus pushed out, how many people are going to remember that they were shitheads about Persona 5 and we'll just be like, well, fuck them.
Well, and it's just weird, again, in this environment that we're in with the internet and people consuming video content and using that for purchase decisions, the worst thing you can do is alienate streamers. Yeah. I could see if I'm a popular streamer and I bought Persona and I can't stream it and they're threatening me, next Atlus game that comes out, I'm not playing
like
it.
In this time where like every fucking video game site and podcast is having regular discussions about, well, is traditional reviews and game writing dead, you know, because everybody's like streaming and doing video content now, like, why the fuck would you like go the opposite way with that? Like, why wouldn't you be as supportive as possible to that, you know, because that is how people make buying decisions now. They don't fucking read reviews like they used to. They usually see their favorite streamers and they go from there. So, yeah, I think it's ridiculous. And I haven't really heard any good arguments for it beyond like, and it sucks. And I feel for smaller developers, but your argument is basically, we want more money, and it's like, me too, you know. Like,
but even that argument doesn't make sense to me, because maybe I'm wrong. I'm not a, you know, I don't know everything, but I feel like they would make more sales than they would lose
if, like, your game's good enough. Most of the time, I would argue that is the case. There are cases, though. I would say that Dragon Cancer is one of them where, you know, you wanna blame Let's Plays and streamers. But at what point do you say, well, maybe my game just wasn't good enough? Maybe it didn't resonate with people.
Well, you know? Yeah. I kind of wonder if you always have a biased view of your own product. And then I think they kind of got a little bit of biased view of the reception, too, because that's a hard game to criticize just because of the...
And I would argue they shot themselves in the foot even further by going so fucking outspoken about it.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Because when you think about that Dragon Cancer, it was supposed to be this big personal statement, and then like after the game comes out, they're just bitching about how we're losing money, you know. So it was like, well, then your audience is like, not only are they mad that they're being chewed out for deciding to enjoy your game a specific way, but now you're making it seem like it was all about money,
right?
You know, it's so
and it's once funny again, because that's a there's nothing wrong with it being about money. That's what it should be. Yeah, but once you actually kind of make it sound like that, or say, yeah, there's, yeah,
like you got to be really careful how you communicate with your audience.
Unless you're and then we just say whatever we want. But
yeah, well, we don't have an audience. We have an audience of fucking trolls.
Good point.
So, if you are Atlus, you have to be way better than this.
Yeah.
Like, not only do I fucking hate what they did, but I think they communicated it horribly. Yeah. So,
yeah. Shame on you. Yeah. So last night, we're pretty much done, but I have to mention, because the other big controversy that I saw today is people are like mad that BioWare said that they're going to address the issues in Mass Effect Andromeda.
That's like bullshit. You ride that failure train.
I guess that's what they want. Like, it's weird. Now, I get theoretically the argument underneath is
sick of patches. I'm tired of like broken games suddenly working.
Yeah. I get the kernel. The argument underneath is you should have never released this in the first place. You knew it was broken, and people think it's slimy for them to release it and then say, okay, now we'll fix it now that you've bought it. That's just the reality of games, though. I'm not saying you can be happy about it or whatever. But the point is, it's already out. You already spent money on it. Now you can't be mad when they say, okay, we're going to fix it. Like, what are they supposed to do?
We're going to make your game that you already bought better. And you're like, fuck that. Like, it should have been good when I bought it. I'm fucking done now. Like,
that's like those, because you've had them. It's like those customers that at a restaurant that order a cheeseburger and they forget to put cheese on it, and they're like, oh, I'm so sorry, we'll get you one with cheese, and they're like, fuck that, it's too late now. And it's like, what? No, what? Then you're gonna eat it as is? Yeah, but I don't want to pay for it. And it's like, but we can fix it. No, fuck that, it's too late. It's like,
no,
basically what you're telling me is you just want to be mad, right?
Yeah.
And there's a lot of people like that out there. Like, they're literally, you heard that there's some people, there's just no pleasing. That's true. There's some people that just want to complain. Like I said, and I get, and it's a valid argument to be like, look, this game was obviously broken. Although it's one of those things like that I figured would happen once it's been out a week or two, you hear it's broken, but it's not nearly as broken as a lot of the things wanted you to like.
I mean, Brad Shoemaker from Giant Bomb, he posted a video with his review, and that game is fucked up.
but there's other people that have gotten through the whole thing without like any of those.
A lot of people saw that video like, that never happened to me. But if that does happen to you, I can imagine you're like, this is like your fucking writer just over an abyss in a T pose. Just like, just like things blinking in and out. And it's like, yeah, if that happens to you, I have no problem with you giving that any fucking score you want. Cause that is busted.
Well, and that's the thing too. I've seen people on the other side that are like too blind. They're like, well, it's. Yeah, it should be addressed, but it wasn't that broken. It was just some, you know, animation glitches, and yeah, they could be goofy, but it was just that. And said, no, I mean, I've heard plenty of accounts, so I've seen people who've had, like, missions completely, like, they get locked out of ever completing. And those, to me, are game, you know, I've had literal games that I've gotten halfway through, and especially ones that tend to do that, like, there's not a save file system, it's just that one autosave. Syndicate, the one that everybody loves, the first-person shooter, and they're like, oh, it's so great and so much fun. I had a mission-breaking bug where you were literally stuck in a room because the door that was supposed to trigger to open wouldn't open, and there was no prior save to go to because they didn't have that kind of save system, and I was 8 hours into the game, and I'm like, well, fuck this. I'm not replaying it. So I get those kind of things. Yeah, so like most things, you get people arguing extreme on both sides and somewhere in the middle, but it's nothing but good that they're going to at least try to address some of these things. But it's just weird to me that people that are like, your game's broken, fuck you. Okay, we're sorry, we're going to fix it. You're going to fix it? Fuck you. It's like, wait.
I mean, people have this hard-on for BioWare, this like they want to hate them at this point.
What's weird to me is they treat it like, because I treat them like a joke because every BioWare game that comes out has these kind of issues. But to me, it's funny because we know that's so going to happen,
Bethesda,
and it keeps happening.
Right? You know, And Bethesda did not get near the same level of shit as Mass Effect Andromeda is currently getting. And I would argue Fallout 4 was way more fucking offensive to me than, I don't mean offensive, like actual like it's content or
so, yeah, yeah.
But the problems of it was just like, this is repulsive. But then nobody jumped down that throat.
And again, it's perception.
Yeah.
Somehow they stay on the fan side. Well, and BioWare though, it's this weird thing where the fans want to act enraged, but they still buy everything instantly and pre-order it and buy the hoodies and figures.
People are in this weird spot right now where a lot of developers sort of came out in support of certain cultural movements.
Yeah.
In our time, and
yeah, that's true.
So they're in this fucked up position where I don't agree with that support, but I loved Mass Effect. So, like, if Mass Effect's not incredible, attack. You know, I knew you were going to ruin Mass Effect. And it's like, I mean, to be fair, the people who probably worked on Mass Effect 2 had nothing to do with this game.
No, in fact, that's a lot of the problem is most of the team from the original trilogy left.
Yeah, and I that was the vibe I got a lot from this, is like, if you're a real, real Mass Effect fan, you know, you might find something to enjoy here, but for a lot of big Mass Effect fans, it felt like a direct-to-DVD version of a Mass Effect movie or something, like, just how that's how Giant Bomb phrased it, and I think that's the vibe I get from it, is like, you know, yeah, if you really fucking like the Mass Effect universe, you might be entertained by this. But, you know, it is not to the standard that, you know, you remember the original trilogy. So, but yeah, people are weird. Yep. Fans are weird, and video game companies are weird, and the fairness, only people, we had our head on straight.
No, we're weird.
I'm right.
Well, you might be.
I am weird, but right now I'm right.
I go for swims before the show, so.
Yeah. You're just fucking, you're still soaked in water and shit.
Pretty much.
Starting to mold. So so we can call that the podcast this week.
That's the podcast this week.
I've been Matlock. He's been Steve.
I have been. I'll be somebody different next week because we like to switch it up. Keep it. Yeah. No, we won't. We'll be the same people. But you love
I'm
us.
I'm going to be Carmelo Matlock next week because I like that name.
I can't think of anything better to end it on. So, yeah, thanks for watching.